Ladies and gentlemen, may I ask you all to join the company in three cheers for Her Majesty. Hip hip!
Hooray!
Hip hip!
Hooray!
Hip hip!
As Her Majesty leaves the theatre, we're reminded that this is the 40th year she's graced the Entertainment Artists Benevolent Fund with her patronage. And we salute the artists who carry forward the great tradition of those who've benefited from tonight's event. And now this is Mike Carson wishing you a very good night from the 1991 Royal Variety Performance. This Christmas on TVS finds Wexford a reluctant holidaymaker.
We are here to relax.
Doing me no good, this flopping around.
And a happy Christmas.
Poirot, however, is looking forward to a break.
This is a matter, I think, not for Hercule Poirot. This is a matter, I think, for the commissioners in lunacy.
I like this fellow. He's funny.
Secrets are uncovered by Anthony Hopkins in Barbara Taylor Bradford's To Be the Best.
We are going to beat her this time.
Black and blue.
Christmas presents from Arthur Daly's grotto prove a little dodgy.
What is it?
It's a digital web timer.
Well, not my fault, Arthur. You didn't tell me you couldn't get batteries for him.
Give us a kiss. It's Christmas.
While Rocky and Laura enjoy the festivities, a delicate case confronts Boone. And raise a glass.
More tinsel, do you think, Pop?
Mm-hmm. Well, just a fraction, Mark. We don't want to overdo it, do we?
The Darling Buds of May join us for Christmas.
Yeah.
The Mondo cinema season continues in 20 minutes on 4 with the first television presentation of the Polish movie A Short Film About Love.
Luckiest guy I know.
He's the little kid trapped in the big body. Tom Hanks is the big kid in a grown-up world. Big, Wednesday at 8 on TVS.
In a few moments on TVS, the national and international news from ITN.
Have you ever wondered why the sky isn't green and why kettles fur up? Or why swallows come back to Capistrano and ice cubes aren't always clear? Or whether fish have dreams and why tea sometimes has a film on top of it? Have you ever wondered about the meaning of water? Have you ever wondered why you're not a brighter person?
What do you think?
Oh, put the kettle on, love. You have got a kettle, haven't you?
Yes, Mum.
And some PG?
Yep.
And a teapot? You have got a teapot.
Mum, just relax. I can make a cup of tea. There you go.
That was quick. Lovely.
100% pure PG freeze-dried granules.
Another cup, love?
Granules.
You found the teapot, then?
PG granules. It's the taste.
Willow is churned like butter. Tastes like butter. And looks like butter. In fact, only the price tells you it isn't. So you can be a little more extravagant. When you want the luxury of butter, but for less bread, wallow in Willow.
I'm Rosemary Conley. I wrote The Hip and Thigh Diet. And this weekend, the Sunday Express publishes exclusively my new whole body program, an essential guide to a slimmer future. This is a program that really can change your life.
Plus your free family ski resort guide, only in this week's Sunday Express.
It had to be you. It had to be you. I wandered around and finally found the somebody who could make me be true, could make me be blue, or even be glad just to be sad thinking of you.
Because the lady loves Cadbury's milk tray.
Entertainment for Sunday evening on TVS. At 7:15, Beatles about with laughter on the menu.
It is you, is it not?
Who is it?
This man is my husband.
Then at 7:45, Means of Evil, the concluding part of Ruth Rendell's mystery.
Axel Kingman murdered her. He tried it twice before, but you wouldn't listen.
At 8:45, London's burning. The nightmare continues for Blue Watch.
We're missing a few hours now. Any chance of a quote on that, sir?
Nobody can survive under this lot.
At 10:05...
Curiously enough, Sunday's show will be the fourth in this, the 11th series of Spitting Image.
An evening of entertainment. Sunday on TVS. Young love is not so innocent amongst the residents of Beverly Hills.
This is going so fast.
We're just talking about it. Wait till you get to the real thing.
She's very romantic and dreamy and sweet, and she's not going to move on that easily.
It doesn't have to be about sex. I hate to break this to you, Mom, but it definitely has something to do with it.
Beverly Hills 90210 in 15 minutes after the national news from ITN in London.
The news from ITN.
IRA bomb store discovered in London garage. Policeman's widow says he died doing the job he loved. Gorbachev bailed out by Yeltsin. Russia will pay the wages. And the late girl from Leeds that keeps them on top. Good evening. Scotland Yard believe they foiled an IRA bombing campaign after discovering a cache of weapons and explosives. As first disclosed on ITN, the bomb store was in a lock-up garage at Wanstead in East London. It was raided after a man, confronted by an off-duty police officer, dropped a bag containing two guns and then ran off.
Tonight's discovery could well provide vital clues for the anti-terrorist squad. An off-duty policeman spotted a man acting suspiciously in Wanstead, East London, and challenged him. The man dropped a bag he was carrying and escaped. Inside the bag, officers found at least two guns. Detectives then discovered a small lock-up garage nearby, in which was what amounts to a major arms and explosives cache, substantial quantities of Semtex and other bomb-making equipment. The contents will now be under close scrutiny. Neighbours were astonished.
It just, I suppose, highlights the fact that if it can be here, how many more places there can be in the country? That's what one would think of straight away. How many more are there like this?
You see, I think the trouble is you just drive in here.
Yeah.
There's no gate, there's no buzzer. We've all got entry phones. But you just drive in and then you've got your garages down here or you park your car outside.
Police will be trying to establish any connection between this incident and the team that blew themselves up in St Albans. Detectives strongly believe that there are other terrorists here on the mainland. Tonight, police are saying very little other than that operations are continuing. What seems very likely is that the terrorists were planning an immediate attack, possibly as soon as this weekend. Robin White, ITN, Central London.
The widow of the police sergeant stabbed to death in North London yesterday says her husband died doing the job he loved. Sergeant Alan King was knifed repeatedly after he stopped to question two men. The Home Secretary, Kenneth Baker, visited the two policemen today who were stabbed in a separate incident in South London. Police are questioning two men about the attacks.
After visiting the two police officers stabbed as they arrested one of the two wanted men, the Home Secretary praised their courage.
I spoke to them both, and they have been very severely attacked.
What did you tell them?
The damages and the cuts. I thank them on behalf of everybody for the courage that they showed.
Constable John Jenkinson was slashed horrifically in the face, neck and chest. Tonight he's stable in intensive care. So too is Simon Castry, whose life was probably saved by the prompt action of colleagues.
Seeing the extent of his injuries and knowing that if I waited until an ambulance came along, then he could lose all the blood in him, together with a dog handler, we drove him to the local hospital on Mayday.
The second man was eventually captured by armed police in Southend. Both men are now at Edmonton Police Station in North London. They're expected to be charged in the morning. Tributes from the public have been arriving all day at Chingford Police Station, where Sergeant Alan King was based. Sergeant King was stabbed to death yesterday.
Officers here have been touched by the tributes pouring in for Sergeant King. They have been deeply affected by his murder, and they say the public's response has given them the strength and the faith to carry on.
Some local children have even been donating their pocket money.
We're hurt. His own colleagues, his very close colleagues on that relief are hurt. As a station, we're hurt. But it's deeper than that. The community in Walthamstow are hurt. And on behalf of everybody, we shall have to get through that period. We will.
Sergeant King's widow, Monica, has thanked everyone for their kind wishes. She described Alan King as a wonderful, loving, caring husband and father who died doing the job he loved. She said he was a people's policeman who loved being out on the streets with the community. But he'd often warned her, you just don't know what's around the corner. At the police station where he worked, his fellow officers are tonight coming to terms with the prophetic poignancy of those words. Glenn O'Glaser, ITN, North London.
The Russian President Boris Yeltsin is offering to bail out the Soviet central government. He'll guarantee the pay of millions of government workers, following the state bank's announcement that it had run out of money. But in tough new measures in Russia, prices are being increased while wages are frozen.
Optimistic, да?
Optimistic.
Relief in Red Square tonight after the news that army officers will, after all, be paid this month. Crisis talks at the Kremlin, ending with Russia stepping in to pay the union bills. The meeting between Mr. Gorbachev and Boris Yeltsin was called at only 12 hours' notice after yesterday's announcement that the Central Union Bank had run out of money. Now Russia will release 90 billion rubles to the state budget. Today's economic crisis averted, but the wider economic catastrophe of hyperinflation fueled. In Moscow's private shops, prices are soaring, inflation running at 50% a month. This woman counted out 4,000 rubles for a winter coat. The average monthly salary here is 300. And for those queuing at state shops today, there was outrage when Russian news reported that from December the 15th, all Moscow prices will be freed. It's the last straw. We're finished, said this man. Finished, he believes, because starting from Monday, the city's banks have announced that all salaries will be frozen. On state television tonight, Boris Yeltsin introduced his austerity program. It's a tough budget, requiring tough measures all round, he said. He's taken the risk, launching a free market whilst freezing wages. Today's measures could well turn the widespread despair now felt here into mass anger and full-scale protest. Boris Yeltsin took control of the budget today and also prepared for full-scale market reform. He also announced his opposition to Ukrainian independence, which would wreck his plans if they introduce their own currency. And if Russia's radical economic reform plans are introduced this week, they'll be the biggest risk of Boris Yeltsin's career. Penny Marshall, ITN, Moscow.
Here, the Conservative Party chairman Chris Patten attacked the Labour leader Neil Kinnock today over Europe, and he said Labour wanted to gag their leader to stop Mr. Kinnock making gaffes. But the Shadow Employment Secretary, Tony Blair, accused the government of isolating itself from other EC members over the proposed social charter.
Some tough talks are need to be expected as all countries manoeuvre for position in the closing days before Maastricht. The Tory party chairman joined a ministerial onslaught over Europe today, which has two purposes: to reassure Tory backbenchers there'll be no sellout, and to warn other EC countries Britain won't be bullied. There were harsh words also for Neil Kinnock.
Now it appears that his idea of diplomatic negotiation in Europe is to give everyone else whatever they want. That's not diplomacy. That's surrender.
That goes down well with all Tories at home. And though ministers are confident Europe knows they won't budge on some issues, they admit that concessions on all sides mean obstacles to a deal are being chipped away.
We've obviously narrowed the range of issues which heads of government and foreign ministers are going to have to tackle in the next 10 days. But there are still some pretty important matters of principle on which we're negotiating.
The latest Mori poll in the Sunday Times shows the continuing volatility of support for the parties. Labour's down 3 at 42, the Conservatives up 1 at 40, and the Liberal Democrats up 3 at 15. But of great importance to all parties, asked what they thought were the most important issues, unemployment and the health service were top, but Europe was named by 32% of people, a huge 23% increase over last month. It shows just how important what's negotiated at Maastricht will be.
But while ministers may warn that there's a possibility that Britain will sign no deal at all, there's also a quiet determination by the British government to achieve the best agreement and sign up at Maastricht. Mark Webster, ITN, Central London.
The Health Minister, Virginia Bottomley, says that the two inquiries set up following the Frank Beck trial should ensure that no child in care ever receives such treatment again. Now Beck's victims are beginning to seek compensation.
David Hunt came up to the Rutland Hills today to try to get away from the emotional pressures of the case. He's one of over 200 former residents of Leicestershire's children's homes who say they were abused by Frank Beck. Now many of them want financial compensation for their suffering.
If it'll give not just me but other people a better chance in life, if it makes things easier, then, you know, we should have it. It'll help us. I mean, it would give me a better chance in life to do something constructive in my life.
More than 20 former residents of Leicestershire's children's homes are already seeking compensation, and some reports say claims could cost the county council's insurers at least £2 million. As Frank Beck started serving five life sentences for his crimes, the health minister claimed today government action should prevent any repetition.
I must make sure that never, ever does such a thing happen again. And that's why we've introduced an inquiry into what happened in Leicestershire, as well as the overall national inquiry in selection.
Greville Janna, the Labour MP, accused during the case of a sexual relationship with a boy in care, won't be charged. The police have apparently found no evidence to substantiate the claims against Mr. Janna. He'll make a statement to the Commons next week. David Rose, ITN, Leicester.
Now with news of today's sport, here's David Bobin.
Leeds United still lead a pleasantly open chase for the First Division title, but they struggle to overcome Everton in their attempt to win the championship for the first time since the early 70s.
It's 17 years since Leeds United's glory days, when Don Revie's men won plenty of trophies but few admirers outside the city. But the new era at Elland Road has brought a different attitude and a team which is rapidly picking up the pace of life at the top. Not that today was a great example of how to win new friends. Leeds struggled desperately to break down Everton's defence. Even Gordon Strachan was having problems finding the target. And at the back, the Leeds defence was frequently embarrassed by Beardsley's skills. A despairing hand from Lukic saved them this time. The second half, though, was notable for two incidents: Chris Fairclough's assault on Mark Ward, which got the Leeds player sent off, and then the late goal, which kept Leeds at the top of the table. A delicate cross from Strachan and a devastating finish from Wallace. After last week's televised spectacular, this was just 3 points in the long campaign for the title.
Last week we proved, or we showed, that on our day we can play a little bit.
And today we had to scrap a little bit, in fact more than a little bit. And obviously when we lost Chris Fairclough, we had to scrap a bit more.
Peter Staunton, ITN Sport, Elland Road.
Crystal Palace took an early lead against Manchester United, McGoldrick's cross and Paul Mortimer's glancing header. Then brilliant work by young Ryan Giggs set up United's equaliser, Palace keeper Martyn helpless from the shot, and Webb's simple header levelled it. United then struck with two goals in a minute, Giggs passed to McClare, and a great finish from the Scottish international. Then Irwin's cross headed on by McClare, and Kanchelskis beat Martyn to make it 3-1, United with just one league defeat this season. Possibly the goal of the season came at Anfield, where Jan Molby struck in only the third minute to give Liverpool the lead. They beat Norwich 2-1.
Leeds and Manchester United still lead the First Division, though. Manchester City are third after their goalless draw with Wimbledon. Hearts stay at the top of the Scottish Premier Division tonight. Scott Crabbe scored their only goal in a win over Airdrie. Goals from Dale Gordon and Richard Gough gave Rangers a 2-0 victory at Motherwell. It leaves them still 3 points behind Hearts. Celtic are third after beating Dunfermline 1-0. Well, in rugby league, in the first of the Regal Trophy quarter-finals, in-form Salford were at home to much-fancied Wigan.
Wigan opened the match in style, the joint favourites scoring first through Sean Edwards after only 15 minutes. Then, just before half-time, an astonishing sequence of events, Botica's penalty kick coming off the post and Dean Bell with a neat piece of handling, giving Wigan a 12-4 half-time lead. But Salford have won 7 of their last 8 matches and staged a splendid fight back, Burkett scoring to reduce the deficit to 2 points. Then Salford took the lead as local hero Tex Evans squeezed in. And the final try in a terrific display of running rugby came from Evans once again. A marvellous match, and Salford deservedly through to the semi-final by 26 points to 14.
Today's big shock in rugby union's Pilkington Cup came at Thurrock, where the home side put out the international stars of London Irish.
Thurrock scrum half Martyn Isles took advantage of slack Irish defending to go over with a great solo run. And they went further ahead with some clever work from fly half John Stephen. His chip was chased by winger Barry Magmuson, who just got the important touch. The Irish exiles fought back, but still lost 16-10.
Tennis, and France go into the last day of the Davis Cup final with a surprising 2-1 lead over the Americans. In today's doubles, Guy Forget and Henri Leconte beat Ken Flack and Robert Seguso by 3-1. Racing, the William Hill Handicap Hurdle was won at Sandown Park by Balasani, saddled by Britain's top national hunt trainer, Martin Pipe.
At the last, native mission clear by two. Two Liadet and Egypt, Bill Prince put ahead of a bad mistake. Shoe flies flying. Make inside the final furlong now. Native mission out in front, but they're queuing up to take him on. Here on the outside, Redcap Balasani is absolutely flying. Look at this acceleration. Balasani steals the race on the line, Balasani.
And the full SP, Balasani at 7-1, Native Mission 9-1, Shoefly the 5-1 favourite.
And that's the news tonight. Good evening.
Agenda Tomorrow reports from Strasbourg on the growing impact of the European community on the south of England. Is Europe improving our lives, or should John Major take a tough stand at the Maastricht summit? That's Agenda Tomorrow at 12:30.
Good evening. Well, this current spell of relatively quiet weather has been with us for several days now, and it looks as if tomorrow will be yet another mostly dry but fairly cloudy day. In fact, as we go into the first week of December, the only thing that's likely to change very much is that the temperatures will be drifting down a little bit, so getting colder but really staying dry with lots of cloud. Lots of mist around at night too, even one or two denser patches of fog to watch out for, so a murky old night to come. A few spots of lighter rain and drizzle too in the northwest, but in the far northwest of Ireland and Scotland, sky is clearing there for a time, so you could have a touch of ground frost, maybe even the odd icy patch to watch out for. It does mean, though, that we all get off to a rather grey start tomorrow. Again, some of the mist and fog rather slow to clear. But I think as we go through the morning towards lunchtime, the grey sky is getting a little lighter and maybe just a little bit of sunshine to come through the afternoon, but most places staying rather grey. The best of tomorrow's weather saved till last up in the far north and west there. A fresher feel to the day there, I think you'll find, and quite a bit of sunshine for the far northwestern corner. Now the temperatures for tomorrow, well, they're already drifting down a little bit. The high is about 10, I think, at best tomorrow. That's around 50 degrees Fahrenheit, but the winds are fairly light, so if we do get a little bit of sunshine, 10 Celsius, 50 Fahrenheit shouldn't feel too bad for the beginning of December. That's it from me then. There's the sunset times for tomorrow evening, and I'll leave you now with tomorrow's summary. Good night.
Oh, no, Rumpole. Surely not.
Mr. Rumpole, did you say you were here to prosecute?
Yes, my lord. Rumpole for the prosecution and Ballard for the defence.
Were you really prosecuting for a handful of silver?
Of course, so that justice may prevail.
Rumpole of the Bailey, Monday at 9 on TVS.
Marking tomorrow's World AIDS Day, a special episode of Beverly Hills 90210 next.
Tomorrow on 4. At 7, Equinox follows the challenge of designing and planning a setting for St. Paul's. At 8, Wicker Way Out West meets the new breed of Speedway rider.
This has got to be what they really meant by Hell's Angels.
And there are no saints in the NFL. At 8:30, the New York Jets clash with the Buffalo Bills, and the Green Bay Packers face Mick Luckhurst's old team, the Atlanta Falcons. Tomorrow from 7 on Channel 4.
Nastiani. Okrose, Cliche, Rapunka Pungi, Larry Grayson.
Larry Grayson?
Kulazi. Tiptongi. Tiptongi. Shatado.
The new Trivial Pursuit Genus 3 edition with 6,000 new questions.
Insurance has a national network of recommended repairers. So we'll get you back on the road before you know what's hit you. Look after yourself properly with Royal Insurance.
I'm Rosemary Conley. I wrote for Hip and Side Art. And this weekend, the Sunday Express publishes exclusively my new whole body program, an essential guide to a slimmer future. This is a program that really can change your life.
Plus your free family ski resort guide, only in this week's Sunday Express.
It must be hard being an angel when the devil in your heart won't set you free. It must be hard being an angel when the world has let you down. Imperfection all around. Hey, look at me. Nobody's perfect all of the time. Nobody's perfect. We are what we are.
Every day, smoke detectors save lives. But because they're often located on the ceiling, they're sometimes difficult to reach and test. Now, from First Alert comes the Torch Test Smoke Detector, the only smoke detector you test with a torch. First Alert, because your family comes first.
My husband says I drink too much coffee. He thinks I should cut down on caffeine.
Relax, darling, lighten up!
So I started drinking Café Hog, and I do notice the difference.
Bye!
Like just now, he's off again to the garden centre. Do I fret and fuss? I do not. I just go right back to snipping and pruning.
Café Hog.
Full of instinct, your whiskers, cats. They know how to tell you what they like. And you can be sure that Whiskers, the world's most preferred cat food, is full of everything they need and love. Cats instinctively know what they like and what's good for them. Cats would buy Whiskers.
Dictionary, £22.99. Lego Euro Freightline, £59. And a baby Shivers doll...
For low, low prices this Christmas, Argos takes care of it.
Curiously enough, Sunday's show will be the fourth in this, the 11th series of Spitting Image. And that's all the facts we've got time for on this, the shortest trailer I've ever done. In fact, that was another fact. And so was that. Curiously enough.
Back to this evening in an hour's time, tour of duty, and then at 12:50, a tribute to Freddie Mercury, who died last weekend. Queen in concert at Wembley Stadium at 10 minutes to 1. First on TVS, Beverly Hills 90210, a special episode.
Season I can sulk and be depressed in.
Don't tell me you're babysitting tonight in every video store.